In this video, we're going to get a quick first taste of Fourier series. We're not going to do a comprehensive study of Fourier series. There'll be a lot more about that later on in the course. This is just the first taste. So what we're working with is we're working on square-integrable functions on an interval from 0 to L. That is, functions on 0 to L that if you square them and you integrate them from 0 to L, you get a finite number. They can go to infinity at points. It doesn't have to be continuous functions. They can jump, they can diverge, as long as the singularities aren't too bad, as long as they're integrable. And we have an inner product on this space. The inner product of two functions is the conjugate of the first times the second integrated from 0 to L. And I claimed in the last video that there's a basis consisting of sine waves. So the first basis vector is, we'll use the Greek letter xi. So xi 1 is the first basis vector. And it's a sine wave, sine of pi t over L. So it starts at 0, goes up, and comes back down. The second basis vector is sine 2 pi t over L. Has two waves, two half periods. Sine 3 pi t over L, sine 4, 5, 6, and here's a picture of sine 9 pi t over L. Okay, so these are all vectors. When I say vectors, I mean they're elements in the vector space. The space is the space of all functions, and these are functions, and therefore they're vectors in our vector space. Now, the lovely thing about there being vectors in the vector space is that they're orthogonal. If you take the inner product of any two of them, then you have to do the integral from 0 to L of sine of n pi t over L times sine of m pi t over L dt. And you can do that using addition of angle formulas. The product of sine times sine can be written as this cosine minus that cosine. And then you work out what these cosines integrate out to. And this term always integrates to 0. This term integrates to 0 if n is not equal to m. But if n is equal to m, we have the cosine of 0. That's 1. And then we integrate 1 from 0 to L and get L. So the upshot is that the product of these two guys is going to be L over 2 if n is equal to m, and 0 if they're not equal. So they're all orthogonal, and they all have the same size. That allows us to use inner products to decompose our vectors. If I give you any old vector, say I claim this was a basis, so I claim that any old vector can be written as a sum over n of some coefficients times the basis vectors. And how do you find the coefficients? The same way we always do. We take the inner product with xi n, divide by the inner product of xi n with itself. The only difference is that now when you take inner products, we're not just taking dot products in Rn, taking a transpose times something, we're taking an integral. So the numerator is the integral from 0 to L of sine n pi t over L times f of t dt. And the denominator, we just worked it out, it was L over 2. So dividing by L over 2 is the same thing as multiplying by 2 over L. So the upshot is we have this theorem that is basically due to Fourier. And that is that for any function, any square integrable function, can be written as a sum of sine waves. And the coefficients are given by this integral, 2 over L times the integral from 0 to L of sine n pi t over L times f of t dt. Now, before I go on, I want to say a little bit about Fourier himself. Joseph Fourier was an interesting mathematician. He lived in France in the late 1700s and early 1800s. He worked on heat transfer and vibrations. That's where he had the idea of decomposing functions as sine waves. Turns out to be extremely useful for dealing with problems of heat conduction or vibration. We'll see that later in the course. He also was involved in translating the Rosetta Stone. And he was the guy who discovered that the greenhouse effect warms the Earth. He also had PhD students, and they had PhD students, and they had PhD students. And so all of his mathematical descendants, his students and his students' students and his students' students' students, according to the Math Genealogy Project, he has 44,866 descendants, one of whom is making this video right now. Okay. So, any function can be written as a sum of sine waves. The coefficients are given by these integrals. When I say it's a sum of sine waves, it means that if you cut off the sum after 100 terms, or 200 terms, or 1,000 terms, you get something that's very close. It's not close for every value of t, it's close in an L2 sense. It's close in the sense that if you take the vector, which is f minus the partial sum, then what's left over is small in L2, which is to say, if you square it and integrate it, you get a very, very small number. Okay, so let's work an example. Our example is going to be of the function, call it a square wave, the function which is 1 from 0 to L over 2, and then negative 1 from L over 2 to L. And for simplicity, I'm just going to take L equals 1. So it's 1 from 0 to 1/2, and negative 1 from 1/2 to 1. And we want to write that as a sum of sine waves. So let's find our first coefficient. Our first coefficient, we have to take 2 over L, but in this case, L is 1. Integral from 0 to L of f of t times sine of pi t dt. Okay, but f is 1 from 0 to 1/2, and it's negative 1 from 1/2 to 1. So we get the integral from 0 to 1/2 of sine of pi t minus the integral from 1/2 to 1 of sine of pi t. And you do the calculus, and you wind up with minus cosine pi over 2 plus cosine of 0 minus cosine of pi over 2 plus cosine of pi, and that all adds up to 0. And it shouldn't surprise us that we don't get any coefficient, because what we're doing is we're taking the inner product of the square wave with this sine wave. It's going to give us positive terms over here, and it's going to give us the product is going to be negative over here. And what happens over here is exactly going to cancel out what happens over here, and the total integral is 0. On the other hand, C2 should give us something, because our second thing is this. So if you multiply sine of 2 pi t times our function, where the function is positive, sine of 2 pi t is positive. Where the function is negative, sine of 2 pi t is negative. So that inner product is bound to be non-zero, and let's work it out. So C2, we have to integrate f of t sine of 2 pi t dt. And as before, f of t is 1 and then it's negative 1. So it's we get the integral from 0 to 1/2 minus the integral from 1/2 to 1. We get 2 over 2 pi cosine of 0 plus cosine of 2 pi minus 2 cosine of pi. And that gives us 4 over pi, or 8 over 2 pi if you prefer. C3 gives us 0 because what happens on the left-hand side exactly cancels what happens on the right-hand side. C4 also gives us 0 because we wind up with what happens here cancels what happens here. What happens here cancels what happens here. C5 gives us 0. The next thing that gives us something is C6, and the next one is C10. And C14 and so on. In general, the nth term, you have to integrate sine of n pi t, and it works out to 2 over n pi times cosine of 0 plus cosine of n pi minus twice cosine n pi over 2. Whenever n is odd, this cancels this, and this is 0. Whenever n is a multiple of 4, this is 1 plus 1 minus 2. Whenever n is 2 plus a multiple of 4, then you get 1 plus 1 plus 2. So the end result is we get 8 over n pi if n is 2, 6, 10, 14, and so on, and 0 for anything else. Okay. So let's look at a picture of what that's like. If we just take the very, very first term, we just look at the very first term, just C1 sine, we get this dashed line. If we take, this is sine of 2 pi t. If we take the sine of 2 pi t plus the sine of 6 pi t term, it wiggles a little more. If you take the sine of 2 pi t term plus the sine of 6 pi t term plus the sine of 10 pi t term, you get the one that wiggles the most, and that seems to be hugging the curve the most. You take more and more and more terms, and you're going to get a function that goes up and wiggles and wiggles, wiggles and wiggles, wiggles, and comes down and wiggles and wiggles, wiggles, and that is going to be very close to our square wave. It's actually pretty amazing that you can get a discontinuous function as a sum of sine waves, even though the sine waves are themselves continuous. Okay, last thing is a really curious formula, which is that you can look at inner products. The coefficients are related to the inner product of f with itself. If you take the inner product of f with itself, it's the sum of cn xi n times the sum of cm xi m. And the only terms that contribute are when n equals m, because these are orthogonal. So you wind up with cn, the sum of cn squared times the inner product with xi n. So that gives you l over 2 times the sum of cn squared. In our particular example, the inner product of f with itself was the integral from 0 to 1 of f of t squared, and that was 1. And l was 1, so what we had was that 1 was equal to 1 half of the sum of the cn squareds. And the cn squared was, you can factor out an 8 over pi squared, but we wound up with 1 over 2 squared plus 1 over 6 squared plus 1 over 10 squared plus 1 over 14 squared. And if you factor out some powers of 2, this turns it into 8 over pi squared times 1 plus a ninth plus a 25th plus a 49th. The sum of 1 over n squared for all odd values of n. Multiply both sides by pi squared over 8, and that you get 1 plus a ninth plus a 25th plus a 49th plus an 81st and so on, gives you pi squared over 8. If you throw in the remaining even terms, 1 plus a quarter plus a ninth plus a 16th plus a 25th plus a 36th and so on, then you get pi squared over 6.